Albright is an associate professor of English at East Carolina University. He's edited three collections of poetry. He was editor of the North Carolina Literary Review from 1991 to 1996. He wrote and produced both the UNC documentary Boogie in Black and White and Coming into Freedom, the End of the Civil War in North Carolina, an outdoor musical drama. His work has appeared in American Film Review, Black Film Review, Living Blues, and the anthologies Good Country People, Kerouac at the Wild Boar, and Dream Garden, the Poetic Vision of Fred Chappell. I'll let Mr. Albright introduce Mr. Morrow and our other guest. Please welcome Mr. Albright.
Thank you. Thank you for coming out tonight. It's a beautiful day and nice evening in Durham, and appreciate you choosing to come to this beautiful building for this program. I get to talk about the U.S. Navy B-1 around the state some, but it's very rare that I get to do so with one of the veterans, Calvin Morrow, who is here with his wife Gertrude from Greensboro. So he lived the story that I researched, and so much of this program I think is much more interesting, certainly to me, to hear him talk. But to give us a, before I let him start telling some stories and answering some questions, I want to tell you a few things about this band and why they're so important to us today, as well as why they were important to us back in 1942, even though the Navy forgot why they were so important to us. The idea back in the day, before as World War II was getting, the run-up to World War II, was that the Navy needed to change, and it was previously an all-white organization except for cooks. Now, even cooks had been turned over to the Filipinos since the 1920s because of this very kind of anti-black policy that Secretary of Navy Frank Knox had employed. And Knox was not liked by African Americans. One of the Golden 13 tells this story. Those are the first black officers in the Navy. He was also from North Carolina. Tells a story about hearing the day that Secretary of Navy Frank Knox died and how they all started laughing and then felt bad about it. And then they felt good that they'd been able to laugh to see him die. He was that much reviled. He blocked a lot of efforts by the Roosevelt administration to put forward integration policies. Well, the Navy was still resistant, and it would not allow individuals to get rank, but they did begin in 1942 the integrating of their ranks. And so the guys in B-1 were the first African Americans to serve in the modern Navy at any rank outside of a steward. That's cook rate or seagoing bellhop. This was a major move for the Navy at the time, and for the black press, it was good, but for some people, it wasn't enough. There was at the time, some of you might remember this, this thing called the Double V, where black communities were being urged to fight the war at home against racism before we could hope to win a war against fascism overseas. This was a campaign begun by the Pittsburgh Courier in 1942. So there was a lot going on. There was a lot of race violence in the country, a lot of tension. The guys from B-1 were supposed to be, originally it was going to be all of A&T's band. They were one of the best bands, some people would say the best college band in the South at the time. But not all the young men at A&T could get into the Navy. So they started coming around to people like, to schools like Dudley High School, where Mr. Morrow was a senior. And they got 9 kids out of Dudley High. They got 3 out of Hillside in Durham. I was visiting with one of them earlier today. John Mason, we had hoped that he would be here, but he's had some health issues and he's not able to get out of the house right now. But Mr. Mason was in the Hillside Band. It was directed by Lanky Cole, who was one of the best. You remember Mr. Cole? Really? We're going to have to get you on the program.
I knew John Mason.
Oh, really? Well, Mr. Mason was very sorry not to be here. What is your name?
I am Walter Brown.
Walter Brown, delighted to see you here. So I hope you can add some information to this, and please, if you hear me say something that's not right, raise your hand. Okay, we got it. The record was wrong for many years. The Navy forgot about these guys. Okay, that's why it's called the Forgotten First. There were a bunch of guys that were taken to Chicago about 10 years ago, and they were celebrated as the first African Americans to serve in the modern Navy at rank other than galley. And it was the wrong people. They were not the first. Okay? These guys in North Carolina beat them by several weeks, but the Navy somehow just forgot about it. Now, nobody really knows why this happened, and there's some theories about it, and we can talk about that later, but I want to show you a few more pictures here and get this thing going so that we can get to Mr. Morrow. But before I show you anything else, I want to tell you some other firsts for these guys. First people, first black Americans to work on the UNC campus at anything other than service jobs. Okay, Rebecca Clark was working as a maid. Her husband worked as a custodian. So the black community in Chapel Hill got to work on the campus, but only in servant rank. Okay, it's the same thing with the Navy. If you were black, you could go in the Navy, but you had to wash clothes, you had to cook food, and you were not allowed to get out of that rank. So they're the first African Americans to come to Chapel Hill and be and work as professionals. But Chapel Hill was not the liberal mecca that we think of it today. Okay, they would not allow these guys to stay on campus. They had to live off campus in March every morning for about 2.5-3 miles, all weather, okay, to play for colors, the raising of colors. And then they couldn't attend classes on campus, they couldn't eat meals, they had to march back to their barracks, almost to Carrboro, to eat lunch. So they couldn't go into the serving area. So they were treated still as second-class citizens in some ways, but they did get on campus. Several, I think Mr. Morrow is one of the people that told me that they had hope that one day their grandchildren would be able to go to UNC, and that came true. These also were the only bandsmen in the U.S. Navy to ever receive musician's rank without going to the Navy School of Music. Okay? And that means that they were so good, they didn't need to go to the School of Music. They got their training at A&T and at Dudley High School and at Hillside and at North Carolina Central. But of course, the Navy wouldn't have allowed them to go to the School of Music anyway. Everybody else in the Navy playing in bands, and there were over 100 of these bands, they trained out of Chicago. And some people say that was the best jazz experience. That's really what did a lot to solidify American jazz. But that's sort of another story. This is the cover of the book, Be One, Forgotten First. These guys are posing for a publicity shot in Chapel Hill. I'm going to run through some of these. I hope. Ah, that's all right. See what happens now.
Let the lights go down.
Sure, maybe a little, yeah. This is some of the new stories that are coming out about the band. The Navy lost track of them. And this is a recent magazine, Military Officer Changing Tunes. Members of the Navy's B-1 band made music and history as they helped desegregate the Navy during World War II. This is cool now, again, because the Navy had forgotten about these guys. But they've changed it. This is a Smithsonian Institute video, and B1 is now the star of this video right here. Their story is a major portion of the history of African Americans in the Navy music program, even though they were not really in the Navy's music program. They were outside the realm of that. But you can see this online right now. I can hook you up with a YouTube connection if you'd like to see it. It's a terrific video. A little bit about Navy rank. You see, this is in the middle. This is the musician's rank, and this is what's such a big deal, because if you were in the Navy and were black at the time, you would have gotten the insignia on the left over here, and that great big C would be on your upper sleeve. And so when these guys, were inducted in Raleigh, and they went to Norfolk for training, and they got to Norfolk and to get their uniforms, they started throwing them these cook's uniforms. See, there's nothing that looks Navy or distinguished about that at all. It says you are a servant. And so Gavin, a couple of the guys said, "Y'all, we're not cooks. We can't give us these uniforms." They said, shut up. You're in the Navy now. Put these on. So there was some fear at the beginning. Some of them thought that they had been tricked, that they were not going to become musicians because they were not being shipped with their instruments. They didn't have their instruments when they first got to Norfolk. You see, in the middle of the war, how the insignia changed. And that's on the right side right there. So the C in the middle is sort of like the lyre for the musician. It didn't stand out quite as much. But a lot of the black musicians talked about how they didn't want that big C on their uniform because every time they went out, people thought, oh, you're a cook. So it was really a nice thing to have that musical lyre in the middle for a musician's second class rating. This is the symbol, Mr. Morrow is wearing one of these. The symbol in the middle is the Navy School of Music, and this is a design for them to replace what they should have gotten at the Navy School of Music, but again, they were not allowed to go to the school. They were given honorary degrees from the Navy School of Music in 1981. They became honorary members of the Marching Tar Heels in 2007. They played a lot of events in Chapel Hill during the time they were there at Keenan Stadium. They played at a lot of dances where they couldn't dance themselves. They played at places where they couldn't go in except as performers. This is Mr. Morrow in 1942. This is our special guest right here. Just out of Dudley High School, he had to take his exams early, I believe. I'm right on that. Here he is in 2014 in Greensboro signing books at Scuppernong Books. This is Mr. Mason, who we thought would be with us today. This is Alexander Hall. Here the guys are playing for the Raising of Colors at Alexander Hall. So this would happen every morning. And so they've got to get up and walk and march with drums from their barracks on Robertson Street. It's the Hargrave Center, 2.5-3 miles. Everybody in the Chapel Hill black community just about came out on the street every morning and watched that parade. Rebecca Clark, she got tears in her eyes telling me about this, how proud they were of those guys, how beautiful it was to see them, how excited it was to know that they were going to the campus and they were going to be treated like Navy men, not like cooks and cleaners. And then they would be there in the afternoon to watch them march back home. And the guys then, they taught sports, they taught music, they became very important people in the local community. Several of them wound up marrying local ladies there. It's a terrific story about how that band came into the Chapel Hill community and helped start the band at Orange Industrial School. Rebecca Clark was making the uniforms for them with these guys' help. This is part of the time right here, Governor Talmadge in Georgia. In 1942, seeks re-election on a hate plan aimed at Negroes. Georgia was supposed to have gotten a black band with their Navy preflight school. There were supposed to have been four black Navy bands established in 1942. There's no way it could have happened in Georgia with what was going on there. Talmadge had just fired 10 university employees, including a vice chancellor, and one of the faculty people who had the nerve to invite a local black woman to a home ec demonstration in Athens, Georgia. That so incensed them that they would have the nerve to include her, that the teacher got fired, the person who employed her, the chair of the department got fired, and the vice chancellor, all in all, 10 different people. The Capital City policeman acquitted in new hearing on brutal arrest of soldier. That's a Raleigh story right there. The news is absolutely horribly full of these kinds of stories, and we still to this day have not done a proper accounting of all the race violence that happened in World War II. The Army calls it something else, the Navy calls it something else. They come up with these different ways of tabulating what happens. And when you have three people taken off a bus, three black soldiers taken off a bus in Fayetteville and shot by MPs, and you call that not a racial disturbance, it's very difficult to understand how that can be done. This NC woman beaten by cops, convicted by court. This was at an event the band played at. She was on her way to go see the launching of the John Merrick. Of course, a big name in black history in Durham from North Carolina Mutual, a ship being launched in Wilmington in his name. Over 50,000 African Americans came to Wilmington that day to see that. The B1 band was the feature attraction there. This woman, Mamie Williamson, was given a 30-day sentence for not going to the back of a bus. It was too crowded for her to move past the front door. And she got beaten up by the bus driver who had been given power of police and was taken down to the bus to the police station and arrested. Somebody else delivered her teeth to her later. She was, I think, 60-year-old lady. And then she's the one that got convicted and given this 30-day sentence because of resisting arrest. You see, the little one at the bottom, A&T supplies 13 musicians for Navy Aid School. These were actually the first 13 of these guys that signed up in Greensboro. Here's a couple more of the bottom part of that. The Jim Crow units. A Jim Crow unit would be an all-black unit and an all-white unit beside of it. Okay, so the Army was starting to do this. The Navy was starting to do this. The band, B1, got sent to Hawaii to quell racial disturbances there. This was a major document. It's not a very exciting slide here, But in my research, this was a really big deal because it was a confidential document that had not been previously seen. And it, a document, it's called the Negro Problem in the 14th Naval District. This was the beginning of J. Edgar Hoover's attempts at linking communism with insurgent activities, with black leaders, with Japanese. So he was really desperate to find connections. All through this document, you find over and over again narratives about race violence that's instigated by white people and blamed on black people. I'll give you a couple of real quick examples. A couple of comics come into the USO theater and they start doing routines in blackface and making fun of black people. And a black guy throws some popcorn at the comic and a fight breaks out. And the black guy is the one that gets arrested and beaten up and told that he's the one that started the whole thing. And it was all an innocent use of the N-word. That phrase shows up over and over again. It was used innocently. No one meant offense. But it was very different in Hawaii. Hawaii did not have a sense of racism until the white Southerners came. This is imported racism. We have this all over the world. Some people will tell us that it was there were parts of England that were as racially divided as the Southern United States, and it's because of this imported racism. Hawaii was full of white Southerners who had gone out there for labor because we were so impoverished at the time, trying to take their attitudes with them. It also was full of Northern blacks who were not used to this, and so it was a powder keg, and there was a lot of stuff happening. Who was going to stop it? U.S. Navy B-1 got called in. They got brought into Aiea barracks, and that was the last days of Aiea. Then they went to the largest black posting in the world of sailors and had to help build it. They wound up having to paint some of the benches, but they constructed that and then became the Admiral's Band in Hawaii. They were ambassadors wherever they went. Here they are marching in Chapel Hill, coming into town. And once in Chapel Hill, they're going to play for dances, for any kind of formal review. Of course, you know, no recorded music. So anytime we have something going on, we want entertainment. This is the band, or one of their dance bands is going to be called to perform. And it happens, at Hawaii, they were known as the most popular band of the island, the biggest also, 45-piece band. Here they are on the steps of their barracks in Chapel Hill. Here's three of the guys at work in Chapel Hill. I'm getting through these real quick so we can get to this tomorrow. James Parsons, I'll tell you real quickly, became the first African-American appointed to a Superior Court judgeship in 1960 when John Kennedy called him on the telephone. He was their band leader. He was Mr. Morrow's band leader at Dudley High School, and he brought Mr. Morrow and eight of his classmates along with him. Here's Judge Parsons teaching a kid trumpet here. Program shows you here some of the tunes that they're playing. Anchors Away with Honor Crown, Stardust, Marches, The Storm King with a tuba solo, Dear Old South, another march, and then the National Anthem. Their basketball team, okay, USO, and they played clubs all over the Hawaiian Islands. Again, a lot of times places where they couldn't have gone into. There were a couple of clubs that were for black sailors, and they could play for those where they could also dance. Illustrations here from the Mañanin. This is the newspaper, base newspaper from where they were stationed in Hawaii. And Stafford, the guy who's the artist here, was from Virginia, became buddies with several of them. The cutting of the bamboo, I don't know if we can get Mr. Morrow to talk about how awful that was. That was one of their terrible experiences, going up in the hills to cut this bamboo to line the theater. This is one of their dance bands in Hawaii. They had a lot of those. An invitation to one of their parties at Fuller's USO at Pearl City in Hawaii, and their comedy act. When they were doing these routines, doing performances, they would have a big band, they would have a little band, they would have specialty acts and these kinds of vaudeville people. Simeon Holloway here in the middle had a real jive talking routine that he can still quote. This is the largest VJ Day parade in the world, and B1 is the star of it. I kept hearing over and over again how good these guys were musically, and getting to the Hawaiian newspapers, it was very interesting to read the reports that, yeah, the reviews said these were the stars. 14 bands, I think, in this parade. They marched about 3 hours, but everybody thought these were the most fantastic musicians. Their dance bands were competing with professional dance bands who had been recruited en masse. The Navy finally got, by the middle of the war, the Navy had figured out that that recruiting an entire jazz band was really good for morale. So they would go out and try to get an Artie Shaw's whole band. They would try to get him in. And most of them would get in. They all came to Hawaii, and they had battles of the bands. The guys from B1 were often right there with them, the Manana Meteors. But they never won, and the reports always said that they couldn't win because they were competing against these pros. It would be too embarrassing to be losing to a bunch of college kids from North Carolina. Here you see Cole in the band, and it's another illustration by Stafford Evans. Cole's on the piano. This is their Holloway Sleepy, right in front of Sleepy, another one of B1's guys. And here's one of them trying to figure out how he's going to get home, counting points. That's how they mustered out. You got points for being married, points for having kids. If you weren't married and didn't have kids, it'd take a while for you to get out. This is one of their nicest programs in Hawaii, beautifully designed, letterpress with lots of nice images all around it. I got interested in these guys, found out about them in restoring Pitch a Boogie Woogie, which was a black cast movie made in Greenville in 1947. And most of these guys, all these guys were in the soundtrack band. Most of them were also in B1. The Rhythm Vets is who these guys are. After the war, they came back to Greensboro and formed this little combo and traveled around and made some money for dancing, playing for dances. And here they are in Greenville in 1987 after we re-premiered this movie, Pitch a Boogie Woogie, which you were hearing some of the soundtrack earlier. That's Lou Donaldson in the middle. He was in the group that went to Chicago. Walt Carlson on the right was the band director at A&T for many years. Thomas Gavin with alto sax here started the band at Fayetteville State and was their band director for many years. I've told this story about Mr. Gavin many years. I teach at East Carolina, and first time I met Mr. Gavin, I went to his house, and I saw he had a car, on his car, he had a license plate, and it said Earth. And I went in and I was talking to him. I said, "Mr. Gavin, how come you have this license plate with the word Earth on your car outside?" He looked at me like I was crazy. He said, "That's where I'm from, man." And I tell that to students. I think if you could all just think we're all from the same place. We don't need to talk about being from here or there and fighting. We're all from Earth. I love that kind of jazz man's view of the world. Yep, I think that's it. I thought I had a couple of color ones there at the end. But yeah, I think I've done my thing here. If we could get some lights, I'm going to make a couple of comments and try to get Mr. Morrow to tell a couple of stories. I thought I had a couple of pictures from our reunions. As I said, there were over 100 black Navy bands in World War II, over 5,000 musicians in them. There are 9 living today. This is one of 6 for the U.S. Navy B1 band, and 2 others, one still playing in New Orleans and one is still playing in New York. Mr. Morrow has been a great teacher for me. He's been kind and patient, inviting me into his house with Gert over the years many times, and he's been one of the people I would call when I get to a point in the book and say, "I just don't quite understand what's going on here," and he would be very patient and explain it to me once again. But I hope that Mr. Morrow can make just a couple of remarks, and if he doesn't tell you some stories, I'm going to prod him and get him to say a couple of things that I know he's really good at. But if y'all please give a nice hand to Calvin Morrow.
I use the cane most of the time, but I don't think, can you hear me?
Sure.
I don't think I need the mic.
No, you're good.
Mr. Albright has said everything that I need to say. Other than just a few things maybe that I know that he already knows because he's done the research. One you mentioned about J. Edgar Hoover. We had a plant in our band and we did not know it until 60, 70 years later. We had a reunion in Winston-Salem and the bass drummer told us that J. Edgar Hoover had him planted into our band to keep check on us. We couldn't believe it, but it was true. So what you said about J. Edgar Hoover is true. I was 18 years old when this word came that there would be a Navy band. I am 91 and be 92 in April. That's a long time.
And 66 years married to Gert here in December 24th.
This is my wife, Gert. We've been married 66 years.
Wow.
We have two sons. We have three grandchildren and two great-grandchildren.
Wow.
So if I can remember some of the things, I'll mention some, but how about you covered everything?
Mm-hmm.
You really did cover things that I thought I was going to be able to say, but you've already said them. But I will try on some of them. After you live as long as we have lived, and I say we, it's only six of us still left out of 45. And it's only five of us that can stand up and talk. The sixth person is completely lost. He's lost everything. So we're of that group that came along, I think someone called it the great generation, or what was that they called it? That one of
it's one of those news guys, the greatest generation. Yeah.
We're part of it. As we joined the Navy, we thought that we would be in Chapel Hill for the duration of the war. After about 2 years, we found out that we were going to be shipped to Hawaii. But before we went to Hawaii, we had some experiences that black people have always had. It was interesting. When we came into Chapel Hill, I don't know whether you've mentioned this or not, it was kind of strange because people were lined up as we were marching in, going to our quarters. As you said, off the campus, we couldn't live on the campus. They had started to build a recreation center for the blacks. The Navy got with them and said, "We will complete it if you will let us use it to house this band." So we had to march all from the bus station all the way through town, all the way down to our center where we stayed. And this is the building right here. That's the center. It was interesting because I played French horn. And as a French horn player, with this many band members, I'm somewhere in the middle. I'm not on the outside either way, and I'm not in the back. They had some experiences that I didn't have. They said some people were throwing mud on them. People were doing all kinds of things because it was just kind of unusual. If you haven't lived it, you don't know what it's like. If you are black, you know what it's like. If you are older than 40 years of age, I guess. As we spent time in Chapel Hill, it was interesting. We played for the preflight school. This was a school that was training Navy pilots. Not the pilots, but the written material, the things that they were going to do. Because as they trained, they left Chapel Hill, they went to Pensacola, Florida. And we had two or three fellows that were at A&T that had gotten their pilot's license. They wanted to look in to see what they were doing in these classes and they were barred from even looking in. It's interesting. We went over every morning. We played Raise the Flag. We would go to the tin can and stay. Come back and play lunch for the cadets to march. They marched in the mornings also. And let me give you this little tidbit. Old George Bush was one of the candidates that came through preflight school while we were there.
And Gerald Ford crashed two airplanes at Finley Field.
So we're part of that group that was involved in that, but we had nothing to do with anything other than playing music. We didn't eat with them. We didn't sleep with them. We did nothing but play for them to march and concerts and programs and other things in the community. To live that life and to live long enough to tell about it, it's interesting. I tell some of the stories and some of the people don't believe some of the things that I tell them about it.
Let me interrupt you just for a minute.
Go right on. Anytime you want to interrupt.
The Chapel Hill Police Department was notorious at this time. It's fortunate for them that their records were all burned in the 1950s. But you can go to the newspapers and read how awful these guys were, especially to black Americans. The near riots, the riots, the incidents of beating of young people, pulling them off the streets. And there were two policemen and a chief of police. And it was the same three guys over and over and over again. And the Daily Tar Heel was the only local news organization that paid any attention to it. Now, Durham had that Carolina Times, and that guy, Austin, he was all over it, but that was just going to the black community, okay? But the Daily Tar Heel was putting it out in the face of all the white people and calling names and saying these police are really corrupt here and making these investigations happen, but nothing was really happening with them. But still, the Tar Heel was the one thing. And on campus, there was a group called the Snuff Buckets that nobody has paid much attention to. That was black and white kids meeting together to try to figure out how to advance some kind of integration. Lots of kids coming over from Bennett and A&T having interracial meetings on campus. And we don't hear much about that these days. The kinds of things that Frank Porter Graham was doing to try to make some progress in race relations in the South. But the incident I was going to mention real quickly was when one of the guys was supposedly said something or looked. I know in Greenville you could get hard time if you were a black male and you didn't step off the sidewalk when a white woman walked by. That was considered assault. And you get 6 months. Okay, that's the crime, and that's the verdict. I don't know how bad it was here, but something happened, and the cops came to that little building here in Carver in Chapel Hill, and knocked on the door and said, "Get everybody out. We've got a lineup. We've got these two women out here. They're going to identify the one of you that assaulted or said something wrong." So Judge Parsons went back in and said, "Okay, I'm going to go get them." He went back in and called the Marines. I didn't believe there were Marines in Chapel Hill, but there was a Marine unit. So they called the Marines. The Marines come over, and they come in the back windows there. This is kind of below ground. There's a bottom floor. Yeah, so they come in the back windows there, and they tell these cops to come inside, and they've got the lineup ready, and they come inside, and they take the cops. The Marines take the cops out. But the records for that are all gone, so it's only oral history. Everything in that Chapel Hill police department just disappeared. Excuse me.
Not only did that disappear, almost the entire thing disappeared with the Navy. The same thing that you said. We have a video that we made, and it tells how the Navy just kind of acted as if we were not a part of World War II. You've covered so many things, I don't know. Let me tell you a little about Hawaii. After spending 2 years in Chapel Hill, we got orders that we were to go to Pearl Harbor, and I think you explained most of it. But I think in the beginning, we were supposed to be the fleet band, Admiral Nimitz fleet band. But when we got there, we were all black, and they did not know what to do with us. They did not know what to do with us. We stood out on beside the ship almost all day, and about a quarter of a mile down from us, they had the LSTs that were loaded with ammunition and soldiers going down, as we call it, under, down in the Pacific, fighting the Japanese. One of them blew up, and we were shocked. Seven of them blew up while we were standing there looking at them. When it came out in the paper the next day, only one ship and a few soldiers were hurt, but we could see men flying in the air as they were blowing up. But that was never known.
That was kept classified till about 1970, and it was not, I think it was about 1970, they revealed it was 150 some killed, at least seven ships blown up, and it was a series of explosions where one blew up, and they were getting ready for the invasion of Saipan. So there was all this activity, and whether somebody dropped a, they don't really know what happened, but the boats, the LSTs were the loading ships with the ammo and that they would make the land the troops in also. So they were getting them ready to go to war, and that's what they were seeing. And everybody on the island, as well as I think many of the men, thought it was Pearl Harbor all over again. Because, you know, this was the middle of the war. Pearl Harbor was, you know, when you're going from Chapel Hill to Pearl Harbor, that's a pretty frightening thing. In the middle of World War II, and especially for young men, many of whom had never been out of North Carolina except for that trip into Norfolk for training.
Yeah. And we were right there in the middle of it. But the strange thing about it, this all-black band, 45 pieces, they really did not know what to do with us. They really didn't. Because
you didn't have instruments. Every time they sent them somewhere, they'd leave their instruments.
About it, all Navy bands were small bands to be on ships. And we were supposed to be in the Admiral's band. And when we got there, it was almost confusion. Guess what they did? There was a little city called Pearl City, down from the harbor, where they had all of the 50 gallons of fuel, airplane fuel, diesel fuel, and it was manned by all black sailors. That's where we were sent. We called it the Banana Barracks on the hill, red mud everywhere. But that's where we stayed for the duration of the war. But we played all over the island. But we were black, and they kept us black. Now, let me come back to the closing of the war, because you covered everything. We did march all over the island, and when the word came out, the Admiral said that was the best band in the entire parade, because we were the big band. There were no real big bands other than our band.
They were the only 45-piece band outside of the Great Lakes in Chicago. So almost everywhere else it would be a 17, 18, that's sometimes right, a 22-piece band. So they're putting out a really huge sound. Very, very amazing.
Now let me tell you one little story. Still talking about racism. Even though the Navy was changing, as you said, when the war was over, the first people that were discharged were the ones that had families, large families. The next people were the ones that had small families. The next were the ones that were married. And the next were the ones that had dependents. I had put my mother down as a dependent when I joined. So I was able to leave after all those with families left, but we still left a few there. I came home on the USS Saratoga, That's a big aircraft carrier. They made it a troop ship. Now going over, we went over on a Dutch freighter. Just like this, all the way. And the people that had weak bodies, they were doing this all the way. You know what I mean by that? They couldn't take it. It was just like this. But coming back on the USS Saratoga, big aircraft carrier, it was just smooth, just like this. We stayed out on the deck almost all day, just enjoyed ourselves. And when we got into San Francisco, I happened to be the only person in the group, because I had been let go in Hawaii by myself, with nothing but white sailors. We came all the way across the country, 5 days and five nights, living together, eating together, doing everything together. I went in Norfolk, so they sent me back to Norfolk. When I got to Norfolk, you don't mind if I tell this little story, do you? When I got back to Norfolk, we got in at night, and I was the only one in the group that didn't like look exactly like the others. So if you look at me, you see that I'm a little lighter, and at night you might take me to be something else than what I am. And they did. But the next morning, I came out and my hair was not like the others. And they said, come right here, come here, come here. They carried me off to another place where they had all black sailors. This was kind of unusual. And in the, that was for breakfast. In the dining hall, they had all the white sailors, all the German prisoners and all eating together. This is what I'm saying, German prisoners. I'm an American sailor. They pulled me out of that group and put me in this group. I said to myself, what did I fight for? Now, I didn't fight on the front line, but we fought a hard battle playing those instruments. We played for the cadets, we played for soldiers, we played for sailors, we played for all of them. But when we got back, the racism hit me straight in the face. I'm a poor little sailor by myself, pulled out and had to live with it. But I look back and I think about the experience that I had. When I came out, I was coming back to be discharged. When I came out of service, I was discharged. All servicemen had the GI Bill. That was a big advantage for me. I had finished high school, went to A&T, I got my BS degree, my master's degree, then I was certified in elementary education, I was certified as a principal. And today, I'm proud that I was a part of this group, this big band here, that helped me to be who I am today. And I think about, go back again to Chapel Hill. And Chapel Hill was supposed to have been a pretty nice place compared to other places. You think about Greensboro, think about the problems we've had in Greensboro, and we had in Greensboro. We were there, could not take part in any of the educational experiences other than to be musicians for this preflight school. And after I came back, finished school, married this little lady, I had two kids. My son went to Carolina. His wife went to Carolina. Their son went to Carolina. Their daughter went to Carolina. And all of them finished Carolina. My son went to medical school, finished Carolina. His wife went to Carolina, got her master's in education. Their daughter went to Carolina, and then she finished Carolina and went to Duke and got her law degree. All of this came as a result of this, because had it not been, we wouldn't have been able to do it. And when you look back and you say the progress that's been made, and if you live through it, you know what it's like. Every one of you in here know exactly what it's like, whether you're black or white. If you're black, you know the black experience. If you're white, there is no experience, because everything is white, is white. But just think the progress coming from this kind of thing here. Just think about it. We have a black president of the United States of America. And when you think about this, you don't feel so bad about it. If I hadn't lived to see it, I wouldn't know. 40, there's about 39 of us left, I believe. They did not see, other than three or four, see the change that's come about in this country. And I'm proud to say, I am proud that I was a member of this B-1 Navy band. And what Alex has done in this book, he has documented the history of this band. And every page that he has mentioned my name, I got a little tab on. There's a lot of them. So if you want to find out what Alex has done, please get a copy of this book, and it will give you the history of what we did, what we went through, and I'm proud of it.
There is an index online. You can find all the places that Calvin has mentioned. But I've got to correct. I've got to correct something. Calvin says they were not in the war here. They were musicians. Don't believe that. There was a. Every time they went off base, okay, there was the potential for things to go wrong. This was an experiment in integration, and there were a lot of people that wanted this to fail. Okay, and they all these guys knew it. They all knew that they were breaking this color barrier. Parsons was acutely aware how his men were scrutinized whenever they were in public. They were black and in uniform. Okay, this was the deal. And if you're black and in uniform, we're going to test you in the white world. He counted on them being smart enough to avoid confrontations with authority or with the Jim Crow world in which they lived. Every time I left campus, or when I leave base, Abe Thurman says, I was walking around like on eggshells. Mr. Thurman was from New Jersey. This was his answer to riding the bus in the South. He didn't. You like those women, those beautiful young women at Bennett, their president there wouldn't let them get on the bus? He said, you will not be treated like second-class citizens. You will walk, you will be dressed up, you will put on hose. When you go out, people will see a young woman who knows how to present herself to the world, and we will not allow you to be treated second-class. Because when you go on that bus, you're going to be feeling like you're second-class. And Thurman was a boxer. Now, he could take care of himself, but every time it came to him, he had to keep his mouth shut. Calvin says, yeah, it was tense. We were sitting on a powder keg, and we knew it. During that time, it was rough, but that's how it was. William Skinner said, yeah, we knew how to act in the white world. We knew not to go into Sutton's
and sit down to order something to eat. But even though we were fully well conditioned to segregation, we'd accept it as a way of life. Many times we wondered why we couldn't eat in that big dining hall on campus and had to march all the way back to get their food. This is a terrific story that this man has told, and he's been great for me. We have time for some questions. Are you Talmadge?
Yes.
This is Talmadge niece. I thought I recognized you. This is part of my authority right here. This man...
Let me shake this guy's hand, because I signed his order to come home on the
kidding.
Talmadge niece was the last personnel officer at Manana Barracks, and he retired to Chapel Hill. And so I didn't know that. At one of the reunions a few years back, we were coming to Chapel Hill, and I got this call, and it was him. And he's one of the people that told me all about Manana and how good these guys were.
Not Manana, Manana.
Manana, excuse me. Okay, Bananas. Thank you. Okay.
Manana Barracks.
Okay. And I believe you told me that they stayed busy all the time?
Well, yeah, because, as he told you, they were the hottest musical outfit on the rock. We got routine phone calls. Can we have your band for whatever? You know, every time an admiral got promoted, they had to have a big ceremony.
Yeah.
And they wanted to put on a show. And who could do it best? That band from Manana Barracks. And we were sending them all over the rock, not only to Navy operations, but others, because they were so good. Let me tell you about what life was like at Manana Barracks. We got over 4,000 enlisted. That's sailors to us Navy guys, right? And what they were doing was handling cargo for the Naval Supply Center. All kinds of cargo. Everything from bananas to bombs. They worked 24 hours a day while the war was going on, and quite a while after, cleaning up things. I think when we took inventory, the Naval Supply Center had enough propellers for keeping the Navy battleships supplied for 50 years. What were they good for? We were no longer a battleship Navy. They're scrap. But that'll give you an idea of the size of the operation. I had, at one point, the keys to all the warehouses where the Navy had coffee stored. This is green coffee. It hasn't been roasted yet. Over 6 million pounds of green coffee, which was put on the market when they were closing down the war, for such outfits as Folgers and so on to come and bid on. They had to get rid of it. But that's the kind of cargo volume we're talking about that all these folks had to have. Now, the life there went on 24 hours a day. The chow hall never closed. You could get a full meal at 3 o'clock in the morning. The only rule was, if you took it, you ate it. Don't waste food. I was personnel officer, I should explain that. The hierarchy was a commanding officer, the executive officer, and then the personnel officer. So in the power structure, I like that word, you know. I'm in the power structure.
You had the power.
I'm number three. You want to know how old I was? 21. I was a kid. I got my hair cut special way, and I passed for 27 because I wanted to be at least a couple of years older in effect to all these guys that I'm, shall we say, taking care of, depending on how you define that. I had to do the lineup for the captain's mass. Now, captain's mass in the Navy is municipal court. That's the little misdemeanors kind of things. You're late on leave, you know, you're late getting back and this kind of stuff. We didn't have a lot of that. What we did have was things like this. We ran an elementary school because when FDR told the Navy, you want more men for this, fighting this war, you got to take everything. No more being selective, and the only blacks you'll take will be steward's mates. What's a steward's mate in the Navy? That's an officer's valet in a nice way. You can think of other terms for it. You got a good one? You're a servant. But they had to take everything that was in the age range. We were getting kids who had never been in a classroom in a school in their life. They couldn't read or write, couldn't sign a name, they couldn't make an X. Was it their fault? No. We ran an elementary school to teach them the basics because they needed to be able to read and write to handle cargo. We had fiascos like the Navy had two kinds of butter. One was canned butter and the other was preserved butter. Canned butter wasn't preserved. You had to keep it refrigerated to save it. A shipment comes through of canned butter. And what do they do when it comes to Hawaii, it's a big cargo ship? They unload it and put it in a warehouse. The warehouse is tin roof with a sidewall in the Hawaii sun. They put the canned butter in one of these warehouses. No refrigeration, no cooling system whatsoever. And about 10 days later, it sounded like an artillery barrage. Those cans were exploding. Biggest mess you've ever seen. People didn't know any better. We taught them. We ran a school. We had big, what the guys called a 10-ton diesel flatbed truck. They were big. They could hold three of those battleship propellers at once. I don't know the weight of them, but it was tons they weighed. They stood about 20 feet tall. The guys got the job of driving these trucks. They were delighted. They were king of the road. We never had any behavior problem with them. They kept their trucks spotless because they were on the road in their truck. As long as they made the hulls that they were assigned, they were on their own. They had, in their eyes, they had a great job. And things like that.
Hey, y'all had a pretty good job compared to some of them,
that's right.
The entertainers. Yeah. We want to have some time here to see if people have some questions for you and him yeah. both.
Well,
he's got a great story about them playing at a dance that just wouldn't stop, too. I interviewed him extensively for this book. But we're about running out of time here. We want to see if we got some questions.
I could go on, but
we all could. Yeah, I talk until a bell rings. But usually,
I can appreciate your feeling when you get those orders. You're going to Pearl Harbor in the middle of World War II. That was not a good news piece of paper, was it?
No, it wasn't.
But you know what, Pearl Harbor was to a lot of us a picnic. Compared with Guam and Okinawa and Saipan.
We used to call it Down Under.
Yeah. We used to go out and pick pineapples fresh. You didn't do that.
Talmadge was from Greensboro, and the Navy had this practice, like most military, they put white men usually in charge of black bases. But they didn't know that Talmadge grew up as a Quaker, and so they were not expecting quite the kind of character that they got in charge. The guy Grady Avent, did you know Avent?
Well,
he was there before. He got busted. There's a really wild story about the investigation that went on with their base commander Avent, and he wound up finally getting busted. They told me awful stories about Avent, and then I found these sort of secret story reports about the investigations that were going on that got Avent busted out. But,
let's see if we have some more
questions. Yeah, let's see if anybody has some questions.
How old are you now?
Where is John Mason?
John is at Canewood Street. He's back in Durham. He's in the house that he lived in for many years with his wife. She got sick,
and went to Charlotte with the kids. And then once his wife passed, he came back to Canewood. I've got his phone number. He would love to see you, I'm sure. He's housebound right now. He's got a leg condition, and he thinks he'll get his legs unbound going back to a doctor later this month. His mind is still very sharp, and he is pretty active, but he's very disappointed not to get here now.
All right.
Yeah. But he would love to hear from you. That's why he came back to Durham. He didn't know anybody but family in Charlotte, and he's back here. Yeah.
I'd like to know a little about the band director at North Carolina A&T.
Walt Carson?
Yes.
He was our trumpet player, and when we were discharged, he came back. Bernard Mason used to be the band director. He went to
He got hired at Howard.
Went to Howard. Yeah.
Howard's music program got stolen. They stole A&T.
Yeah. Walt Carson became the band director, and he was the band director until he retired. He died about 5 or 6 years ago.
He was one of the people who had a pilot's license. He and his brother John were hoping to go to Tuskegee. But while they were waiting for a place to open up at Tuskegee, the Navy band came about. I think they're the only two people, and maybe in all the Navy, that didn't do training. They joined the guys in Chapel Hill. So they got somebody washed out in Norfolk. But John and his brother, Walter, were pilots. And they were the two. John is the one who told me the story about listening to the lessons on aircraft. And he was standing outside. He was so excited to hear a teacher telling them this lesson. And then they're both standing there. And then the instructor comes over and just pulls the door shut because they knew they were out there. Yeah. He was a terrific fella, yeah. Did you know him?
No, but I knew Lanky Cole, who came to Durham from Hampton.
Uh-huh.
And he was quite an institution in his own right.
Right, yes, that's what I understand. I'm sorry I never met him.
He did the Bull City Nighthawks.
Okay.
With a jazz band in Durham. Go ahead. I don't want to.
Well, you know, Doug Clark is Rebecca Clark's son, and Doug was one of the kids watching this band parade, and he so much wanted to be Walter Carlson when he grew up, and his brother John Clark wanted to be the drummer Morgan. Yeah. So they were Doug Clark and the Hot Nuts traced their roots back to U.S. Navy B-1 band.
Yes, yes, yes.
Well, let me say this about the musicians' equality. They were excellent. We had a movie in the outdoor movie theater, nice stage and all, but couldn't start the movie till sunset. And so they were authorized to play music of their own choice for 30 minutes before the movie started. This was for free, you might say. It wasn't part of their duties. They weren't being paid for it. Did you ever do that before the movie?
I played French on. I didn't.
You didn't get in those jam sessions.
No.
Well, they'd have real jam sessions. And one night, I'm there, going to watch the movie. But I get there early because I like the music. And they were really going. I mean, they were hot that night. And they had the kids in the audience dancing the aisles, dancing on their seats, whooping and hollering, and it was a real happy time. I mean, they were going, passing the music around to different guys, you know, and they'd take a chorus on it and really hit the licks. And the time is going, and it's getting dark, the sun is long gone, and they're still up there going hot. And the officer of the day, one of his duties was to be sure that the movie operated on time, he's pacing up and down. What am I going to do? I can't stop the movie. They're still playing. And I'm sitting there loving it. You know, this is great. And finally, he really gets desperate. I says, just tell the projectionist to start the movie and then turn off the lights. And he did. And they played about 5 minutes more, and then they slowly died out. But you could go there every evening and have that session. Great musicians. They're working on a movie, John Coltrane's biography, right now.
So they caught up with you, huh?
Yeah. And he was a part of
it. He was in the replacement band. Coltrane came into Manana Barracks after these guys left.
You see, Manana had a small band before, and that's how you guys got sent there, because it was the only place where they can hide more black guys.
They didn't have anywhere else to send us.
There's nothing else on the rock.
That's right.
Like that.
I was going to ask, the big band, the 45-piece band, what was your repertoire? Was it mostly all patriotic kind of stuff, or did you get to play some popular music too?
We played concerts, popular music, all of it.
You could kind of decide what you wanted to learn and play? You had some leeway there?
We had a concert. We played concerts on the campus all the time.
Nathaniel Dett was at Greensboro, and he was one really a huge influence on American music, and he was bringing Americans, the spirituals, into kind of concert music.
Sure.
And so Dett was in that group with Bernard Mason, and so there was a lot. And Greensboro was really high art. The influence is there, and that band played literally everything.
Well, I mean, back in those days, that's, you mentioned, you know, Artie Shaw. I mean, that was big band heaven days back in the 40s. And
but they were playing.
I would imagine if you made some arrangements to play some of the real big band popular stuff, you could really play.
Okay. Yes, but we were really a marching band, concert band, and we had a jazz band that was
two 16-piece bands broken out of it. And that's when you look at that record, you'll see a picture, and that photograph on the cover of the book is one of the dance bands. This was the Cloudbusters in Chapel Hill,
and they'd go out and do shows, do appearances on weekends, that kind of thing. As the Navy band, they had to take the Navy orders, and they'd get sent down to Pearl Harbor to 14th Naval District Headquarters for some big ceremony, and they would lead the parade.
Well, a 45-piece band's a pretty big band. I played in a high school band that wasn't much bigger than that when I was in high school.
45-piece is a big band.
Yeah, absolutely.
Big band.
And I was looking at, you've got the whole range of instruments in the picture there. I was picking them all out.
They would practice on the main street of the Manana Barracks, where my office was in the administration building that set up on a little knoll. Incidentally, Manana Barracks was hidden in a cane field. Remember the cane field?
Oh, yes.
You took the highway from Pearl Harbor north toward Wahiawa.
And you remember Pearl City?
And at Pearl City. There was a little sign that said Pearl City, but that was off to the left. But just beyond that, there was a road went off to the right. No sign. But that went to Manana Barracks. You went back in the cane field about 300 yards, and lo and behold, there's all these barracks and everything. Big fence around it. We got all these black guys protecting them, right?
Are there any recordings from those days?
There's one, and that's on that CD. There's a one of the dance bands was recorded on KGU, and one of the members of the band smuggled that record out. I believe you told me that everything got dumped in the ocean of the full band. There were some made, and it's still hopeful that one day that'll show up. It's in a big acetate disc somewhere.
It would be fun to hear.
You were forbidden to bring certain things back, but they had to get rid of it.
Yeah.
For example, they were not going to bring back all the bulldozers that cleared the jungle so they could have landing strips on those islands as they marched along. Sure. What did they do with them? They just ran them back into the jungle and left them. What did they do with a typewriter or something like that? They would have a barge down there at the dock at Pearl Harbor, and you were ordered to take all of them and dumped them in the barge, and they towed the barge out to sea and opened the hatch and let them all settle to the bottom.
So what about the instruments that the band played? Were they
belonged to the
Navy supplied Navy instruments? Yeah. So probably variable quality.
I wish I could have kept my French on.
Really?
Yeah.
French horn.
Had to leave it. But we played all of the great music. Tchaikovsky, Beethoven, okay. Schubert,
concert
all
band,
it.
Too. Yeah. Playing a lot of John Philip Sousa or some John
Philip Sousa.
Oh, yeah.
That was number one.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Man, I'd love to have
and
heard
they,
that.
Stars they would, and Stripes for
they him. Would sure. practice up and down that main sure. street in the Manana Barracks right out in front of where my office
now,
was.
You didn't do any stuff like today's college bands with formations. You were pretty much just a get one formation and march.
That was what we were. We were a marching band.
Right.
They didn't do.
We didn't. We didn't do any formations at all. I don't believe. No.
Probably wasn't any reason to.
No.
You
know, no. But now after the war, Carlson went back to Michigan, or Michigan State. That's where he learned that fancy, like the you yeah. see the FAMU and all that kind of
sure.
fancy stuff, and
sure.
so that all that was starting to change at the time. But that was and then Gavin. And Jones took that style, and all over North Carolina, you started getting bands. Still, Goldsboro today has got one of the best high school bands you'll ever see. Greenville had, Kinston, the band director that taught Maceo Parker there. He was a B1. Lots of the B1. Most of them went into education, and that's another part of this whole. The whole thing here is thinking about how they taught the kids that were going to be the generation that was going to go through all this stuff. They were teaching the kids that were going to the lunch counter at Woolworths, you know, all over the state. And there has often been a tendency to think that there was too much patience. But people forget what it was like during that time and how walking on eggshells means really, you know, things could go bad really quickly here, and we have to be very careful. And so there was a lot of wisdom gained from that generation of people passing it on to their kids. Yes.
Getting back to your question, we were a marching band and a country band.
Okay.
Mr. Mark, did you continue to play music when you came back to North
Carolina? I played in A&T's band for 2 years. People ask me now, do you play the French horn? 70 years ago, I'd have to relearn it.
Get those lips back in shape.
The embouchure is gone.
Yeah.
I pick up my trumpet every once in a while, and it's no good.
But I had the pleasure of sitting at my desk and having them, in effect, play for me
sure.
out there in the streets.
Sure.
Because the building was open. It was not enclosed as such.
Right.
And so I could hear them just like I was sitting out in the football stadium and they'd be playing.
How much did you rehearse every day?
We rehearsed at least 3 hours a day.
Okay.
We rehearsed in the tin can. That was the big tin can.
Oh, tin can was still there when I was in school.
And then when we got back after we had, before we had dinner, we rehearsed in this building back here.
Yeah.
And how about at Manana?
Well, the same thing. We rehearsed.
And at Chapel Hill, they also played for the cadets changing classes, and they played what Thurman, I think, called them a grinder. You play three or four marches real fast and move the guys
okay.
around. So all the movement is being marshaled by music.
Sure.
Everything
sure.
is.
Sure. Yeah, 10 can.
Yeah. Any other questions?
You were asking about, do I still play? No, I had two boys, two sons. Both of them played sax while they were in high school.
A lot of them did continue to play, and you know, one of the things that when the schools finally did start integrating in the late 60s, early 70s, I know in our experience in Alamance County, it was a lot more universal and a lot sadder than in the end than what you think about how so many of the when the schools were coming together, how so often the white band leader took over the program, and how the black band leader went to teach shop or some other course. And that happened all over the South in these communities where the band, young men had literally built the band in the school and dreamed of integration. And then when it comes, then they're told, you can no longer be the band teacher now. You have to go and teach shop or something like that. And
I would guess a big number of the B1 veterans came back to North Carolina.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Have you ever, Mr. Alex, have you ever thought about doing a musical tree of B1 band members, and where they went and studied, which ones went to work, schools, and that'd be really interesting. It really is. The influence.
Yeah, Carmichael was one of their buddies, and I saw his picture on the wall.
Rufus Carmichael.
Yeah, right there.
My band director, Ray Amon.
Yeah.
How about that?
Yeah. He was an exception. He got to keep the band job there.
He was my band director when I was a grade.
But that's a great project, and yeah, there are many of them. It would be fun to see
the influence through the generations of those band members.
Low-rate these guys because they didn't do a lot of the fancy stuff that bands do now.
Sure.
None of them did that until well after WW2.
I understand.
You went to a football game that period, and they marched out and lined up and played three or four pieces at halftime, and that was it.
I was glad my band didn't do much of that because it was all I could do just to play and walk in a straight line.
Yeah, one of the most interesting events they played for was the baseball All-Star game. It was the only year that the Major League didn't have an All-Star game, and it's not even in the history books, and nobody knows the score because it wasn't recorded and they wouldn't publicize it. But Ted Williams, they got together all the Major League players that were in the Navy, Williams who had been in Chapel Hill. So they put together this All-Star game and played it in Hawaii, didn't announce that it was going on because they were afraid anytime they announced something they would get bombed. So they had this game, brought the band in to play, the game was over, and that was it.
Wow. Let me share this with you. All of you from Durham. You remember Kate Smith? Singer, Kate Smith.
On the radio.
Yeah. We played at the Carolina Theater, I believe it was the Carolina Theater here in Durham. We the music backup for Kate Smith. That was unusual because blacks couldn't go in the Carolina Theater other than the roof.
That's what John Mason just told me this story today. I'd never heard his version of it. He said, talked about climbing all those steps in the theater and how that one day when they got to go and play for Kate Smith and he was sitting on the stage, he could hardly even play. He just couldn't believe he was sitting on the stage looking at all those white people right in front of him and all the black people up there. And I said, did you ever imagine that you could sit down there? And he said, well, it was kind of hard to imagine. But he just kept talking about the view. That's how astonishing it was to be on that stage and to not be up there looking down.
I need to tell you one more little aspect of this. I got this job, and I'm a really freshly minted ensign. Anybody's organization should never have turned all that responsibility over to me, but they did. And I found out very quickly that I had a power that nobody had ever mentioned. When I had a personnel problem, I could call up the personnel office at the 14th Naval District down at Pearl Harbor and tell them my problem and what I needed. And the answer was, oh, right, we'll get right on that. And they would. I found out that the big-time Navy wanted nothing to do with nice guys like this. They were afraid of them, and all they wanted us to do was to keep them and keep them busy so they didn't get in trouble and made trouble for them. And it all went back to an incident called Port Chicago, which is a industrial port upriver from San Francisco, where they were handling munitions cargo for the Pacific. Trains would come in, cars full of all kinds of bombs and everything, and had to be transferred to ships. And they took these black kids out of the cotton field and whatever, and put them in the loading this ammunition in these ships, and they didn't train them. They didn't train them properly with safety handling. And one night, about 11:30, just after they'd changed ships, this is at Port Chicago in California now, there was a big explosion, totally destroyed two ships. One that had just been completely loaded was going to sail the next morning, and the other they just started on that day. Nobody's ever figured out what happened. But quite a number of people were killed. The two ships just disappeared. Damage to the barracks and all this. The guys that worked, working alone that night, were in the barracks, and one wall of one barracks just collapsed in from the blast. It was so big. They got things shaped up for a little bit, and they're going to take the guys back to work. Doing what? Handling munitions. So they line them up, and they're going to march them out there. And they get to where they have to turn to go out on the pier, and they're supposed to do a column left. They kept going straight ahead. They're all arrested, charged with mutiny, tried, convicted, sentenced. Some of them served as much as 8 years. But this got officers involved in that in real trouble because they had not done their duty of seeing that these kids were educated how to handle this stuff. And this got spread through the Navy. You did not read it in your Durham Herald. This was not broadcast around. But the word went out in the Navy. Don't get involved with these black guys. It's hell for your career in the Navy. And they wanted no part of it. And so what I learned was, if I kept all our problems up there in the cane field, I could do a lot of things. And nobody would ever ask questions. I had a little fun that way when I got that education. And I think we had a pretty good little life up there. It was still the Navy. Couldn't get away from that. But it was not, I don't think, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but it was not a real hellhole.
It wasn't a hellhole, but still.
You were still in the Navy.
It wasn't heaven on earth.
There was no heaven on earth. Exactly.
Thank you all. Y'all are a terrific audience. Please stick around. Ask Mr. Morrow some questions. Mr. Neese, we've got some books and some CDs back here if you're interested. And you can check out that Pitch a Boogie Woogie online. You can see all these guys playing in 1947, 48, several online resources. I have a webpage that's Black Navy bands in World War II, and so trying to document all these other guys. These people I thought were so badly documented, it turns out none of them were really documented. So there's lots of open history out there. Thank you very much.
I want to give you. Thank you.
Thank you for the library, too.
Thank you for coming.